to flare or not to flare? That is the question. It's actually not a question. I'm definitely going to flare this car. I just haven't decided yet how I'm gonna flare it. First and foremost, there isn't a correct way to flare an early 911. Wide body flares were made out of necessity by the Porsche race team. And when you look at all of these early pictures from all the early race cars, there's almost no continuity between one car to the next. You almost get the sense that they were on the racetrack on Friday and Gunther said, hey, I need a 9-inch wheel to fit under here instead of a 7-inch wheel. And they just grabbed what they could and they made the car wider overnight. That's the vibe from these early cars. It's only been in the last 10, 15 years when people have been doing, you know, RSR rebuilds from scratch, you know, every nut and bolt restoration, that they've gotten into this concours, everything has to be specific and correct kind of vibe. You may have watched some of the earlier videos where I've been talking about going double reverse flares. So rear 911 SC flares flipped around and put on the front, and then front turbo flares flipped around and put on the rear. Now, just like everything else on this build, everything is very liquid. And when I bolted those things up and looked at them, I didn't love the profile so much. So what we're gonna do in today's video is two things. Number one, I'm gonna fit the flares up, but I'm also gonna strip all the paint off of them. And I wanna be able to see kind of how the body blends with the flare. So that's the first thing I'm gonna do. The second thing I'm gonna do is address the junction between the quarter panel that I welded and the body. There's a bit of a divot there, and I wanna use body work and patience to smooth that entire area out so it's really ready for some filler. Next, I wanna talk about you guys and really the origin of all of this. In 2000, I worked at Freeze Magazine in Boulder, Colorado, which was a magazine for free skiing and downhill skiing and tricks and stuff like that. And the husband of one of our designers was a racer for real-time racing in the Speed Vision World Challenge. Kevin Schrantz was his name. And we got invited to go down to Pikes Peak International Raceway, PPIR, and literally stand on the pit wall for real-time racing. They have Acura Integra Type Rs, and they were in a real Speed Vision World Challenge race. So nerdy me, who worked in bike shops forever, I couldn't wait to get down there and see like what a real race mechanic does and how I've never worked on a car ever in my life prior to that. I mean, a little bit, but not to that extent. Well, one thing I came out of after that weekend is like, wait a second, these guys are hitting metal with hammers, they're turning bolts righty-tighty, lefty-loosey, and they're solving problems. It didn't seem that intimidating to me. So what I did is when I came back, I actually changed the clutch in my 89 Honda Civic Si. I remember buying a little Craftsman toolkit and a manual from, you know, AutoZone and Home Depot, and I changed the clutch in my car. It went from being at the time like a $750 investment to whatever it cost me, 77 bucks or 120 bucks or whatever it was for my clutch. And it really changed the course of my automotive life because I thought, you know what, I can do this. And what I try to do on this channel is first, entertain. So hopefully I can make you laugh while I'm trying to do a car. And two, if I can inspire or educate and you can learn something enough for you to say, you know what, there's a car that's been sitting on Craigslist and I'm gonna give it a go. You have to understand that I'm not a race engineer. I'm not any kind of engineer. I'm a guy who buys tools at Home Depot and Harbor Freight. For those of you guys in foreign countries, that's, you know, the big box hardware store and the sort of knockoff Chinese tools store. I bought a welder from Craigslist. I bought a car from Craigslist, and I'm trying to make it into something cool. And I do that by trying to be, like I said, interesting and sometimes fearless, and really try to build something that I think is cool for me. And I hope you guys get something out of it. So over the last couple of videos, I've been asking you guys to comment and like and high five when you can and just be, and you've been so cool about it. But one thing I've noticed that I've really dug is a lot of names that sound like they are from somewhere else. So what I'd like you to do right now, especially if you're watching this on your phone or on a computer, is give a roll call. I'd like you just to say your name and then the city and state or the country that you are hailing from, because I think it's going to be cool for everybody to see how one video on a specific subject can bring people in from all over the world. Certainly we need some unity in the world right now, and I think if we can all escape this craziness of 2020 a little bit in a garage, then it's more better. So I would love to see you guys down in the comments, and thank you once again for doing that and sort of helping me boost this channel and the algorithm a little bit. Finally, I want to show you guys really quick. I watched the most recent Chip Foos video, the Foos design video where they're doing the Bel Air. It might have been like a 57 Bel Air or something. But I noticed something in their shop where they had elevated the whole car on these stands that just looked like a bunch of 2x4s. And turns out they're just a bunch of 2x4s. So I went out and bought 8 2x4s and I made these stands that I can put the car level on. If you guys saw the last video of the engine falling over and the car almost falling off the jack stands, I wanted to avoid that at all costs. So now the car is higher. It's fully planted and stable where it is now, so I don't have to worry about it falling over. But this was something I think it was $40 to buy all these 2x4s. I just jacked the car up, I put them down, so now I've got a level car that I can use. It's a little bit higher. I haven't tried to slide the engine underneath yet, but it's very possible. I don't even need to jack this car up anymore to get the engine in from the underside. So super cool, easy project to do, and something you guys could do to make your own car stand. So without further ado, I'm gonna screw these flares on and then grind the paint off so we can all see together and just see how it looks when it's flared. What you're gonna be looking at here is rear 911 SC flares and front turbo flares. And the reason why I've gone away from flipping them the way I was going to is because the car narrows a couple of inches in the back and I didn't account for that. So it just looked a little weird to me. But let's pull the paint off, let's get them on. I'm gonna screw them in with my favorite little tech screws and let's just see how the thing looks with flares that aren't welded yet. So for this, I'm gonna use my cordless Ryobi and a clean and strip disc. I don't know if you've seen these, they pull paint off pretty quick. I may not stick with this because this thing might wear out too fast. I might have to go to my battery operated version. Also, you can see I've sort of duct taped the flares on and I have like one tech screw in each one. So I will stick with that for now until I put a couple more screws in and we're gonna see how this thing looks. All right, I'm making a strategic pivot here. This is a much tougher road, the hoe, than I thought it would be. The stuff is really being grumpy coming off. So I'm actually gonna pull all four flares, take them out to the back, and use the remainder of what I have left of my paint remover, like the real stuff, the dangerous stuff, but the stuff that actually works. I'm gonna use them on these flares first and see if I can get the stuff loosened up, because hopefully it'll clean up a lot easier on the other side. One of those examples where I was like, you know what, give me like 10 minutes, let me just strip the paint off the fenders and then I'll bolt them onto the car so we can have a really good perspective of what they look like. It's like 2 hours yesterday, 2 hours today, 4 hours later I have two fenders done. So that's the real bummer about the old school methylene chloride paint remover not being available anymore. Because it just takes forever to do this. But let me show you guys right now what we're looking at. All right, now that these are stripped, you can see what the profile looks like. I think it looks really good overall. Hey, Ben. I think it's got a really cool profile. I'm trying to show you guys from all the different angles what it looks like. And that's the dog. Hey, Ben. How you doing, bud? Thanks for helping us with this build today. You see why I had to strip the paint so I could get a really nice idea of what the lines look like? I think it looks pretty good. I mean, you know, I love a little wide body, but this is very different because this is 911 SC rear and turbo front. And if you look down the row, they look about even. Actually, this is a hard perspective. It makes it look like the front are bigger than the rear. But if I go back further, if I can, they look pretty, they look like they're sticking out the same. I think what I'll do is I'll measure. I'm gonna figure out a way to measure straight up and down and see if my actual flare is even on each side. And certainly, of course, you see this side, it's not at all. But from this perspective, you can see how the car curves in a little bit. By the way, for the rest of this video, I'm gonna show you guys how I smoothed that out. And I took it from this. So we're gonna do that next. But here's the perspective I want you guys to see. And I think it looks pretty good. Okay, now the flares are on, I'm gonna start working on this section. I'm gonna show you guys how I even out after my pigeon poop welding to try to make a nice flat surface. So I have just a teeny bit of body work to do afterwards. The problem here is that you can't get to the backside with a hammer and dolly. Like I can't hammer out this way. And I've got a little divot here. So what I tend to do is use a pry bar to push out the center part, grind down the weld, then I go back and forth grinding, welding, smoothing until I think it's done enough. Now it's worth noting, this is actually a concave piece, so it doesn't need to be totally flat, but I don't have a body gauge. It's kind of this thing that looks like a bunch of needles, and you put it on the body and it gives you the exact form. So what I can do is use my other 69 911 to give me the exact form. I don't have the tool yet, but I don't need it for right now. The main thing is to make this look less Frankenstein-y than it is right now, and just continue to work it so it's nice and smooth. It, to me, is gonna be good practice for when I actually put these flares on, and I wanna make them as seamless as humanly possible. Okay, let me talk procedure before I get into this thing, and then I'll tell you the tools I'm gonna use. First and foremost, I'm gonna wipe this whole thing with acetone. It still has some wax stuff on it that I use to protect against outer moisture. That's why I'm able to keep it bare metal and not rust here in Southern California. Next, I'm gonna be using this primer as a guide coat. And what a guide coat is a really thin layer of paint, or they actually make a thing called guide coat. You can also use a powder for it. But you spray it on, and then when you sand or scrape away the topmost layer, it shows you your high spots and your low spots. So we're gonna use that a lot. But the secret sauce is this thing, which is kind of this body slap file. And these are very sharp. You can see, let's see if I can get it to focus. So this is a file, if it'll focus on it. Yeah, anyway, you get the idea. It's a file, and you hit the metal with it. You hit the flat metal, so it sort of cuts it and flattens it at the same time. And it gives really, really nice results for finish work. So I kind of go back and forth with all those things. I'll take you through it the first time, and then I'll just stick it on time lapse and you can watch me kind of go through the entire process. First thing I do is give this thing an acetone wipe because it's got all this wax on it. Next thing I do is give this thing a light mist coat of this primer. And you'll see why in a second. Next, I'm gonna hit this thing with the body file here. And we're gonna see what I have to work with. Okay, this is a good example of what you can see. You see, these are all high spots. Oh, really, this is the body of the car, which feels pretty good. I can feel a dent here that's a low spot. And then this is the car itself, which feels a little wavy. But then you can see this is all low. I've got a few weld spots that are high. I can hit those really quickly with a flap disc. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to get underneath. I'm going to pry this out a little bit. I'm going to hit it with a flap disc and see where I am. I'm going to run this whole process again. And that's really what this is. This whole process is just as many times as I need to, I run this thing back. I keep going until these low spots kind of blend in with the high spots. And the same thing right here. But I can identify now that if I need to get behind this thing and pull it up a little bit, it's all around this part and then around this part as well and a little bit on the low side here. So I need to do that until ideally when I drag this file across, it sort of files everything equally. So what I do here is I have a long pry bar. And what I'm going is basically up along the weld, right in the middle, and I'm just wedging against the car and pulling it out, almost like you do paintless dent repair. And I'm trying to get all the low spots. Because it's easier to hammer this way. It's not easy to go the other way. I can get a dolly in behind this thing, but like there's a huge divot right here. And I'm gonna have to probably shave this weld down to get it to go flat. This is actually coming really pretty good, pretty quick. I've got a flap wheel with a 40 grit disc that I'm gonna lightly skim to try to get some of these welds off because they're hard and they're preventing the metal from coming back. So I welded this piece of metal onto the end of this bar, which I can take off in 2 seconds. But I thought I would do that to help avoid, I'm starting to get kind of these points, which is the edge of this thing pointing into the bodywork. So I thought I would stick this thing on here and spread the load a little bit. So by the way, we're getting pretty close. I'm gonna pull this center section up a little bit more and then hit it with the grinder and see how close I am. That might be enough. I may need to do one more round of welding, but hopefully not. Hopefully I can just grind these things down and we should be pretty smooth, but it's a lot smoother than it was when we started. Okay, I'm about 40 minutes in. It's a lot harder to show you because it's getting a lot smoother. I'm gonna do one more round of welding. And basically what I do is, when I get close here, I just weld in these spots that are kind of dark. I feel for high spots, which I'm gonna do again with the file. And then I basically wanna see if I can get it pretty close. I'm actually feeling like this and this could be a little high. So I'm actually gonna tap this a little bit with a hammer going to dolly. I can get a flat dolly back there and see where we end up, but it's getting much, much closer. Let me see if I can show you guys something. This is the car telling me it's done being ground. If I get really close here, let's see if I can even see this. You see that burn mark right there? That's the metal telling me that it's really, really thin right there. It's not surprising because this spot right here has been the lowest spot the whole day. If you see this, this has completely disappeared. Like this is totally smooth now. But this spot down here is still the lowest. That being said, I'm pretty happy about this. Like, I can't really complain too much about this. It's not totally invisible. There's still like a little gully, a little bit like that, but this is like one little thin skim coat of filler and then block sanding, or I'll do this with lead and I'll file it, but this is, I mean, it's basically done. If I spray this thing now, you'll still be able to see that there's a seam there, but like, it's not Frankenstein anymore. You know, it's just a hint of a seam. So that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to spray this and then I'm going to call it. So I'm calling this done. When it fully dries, I'll give a camera a little shot of it, but like, if you walk in here, you'll be like, oh, he welded those fenders on, but it's not awful. Like, the worst part about this right here is this little ridge, because this spot was really low. I had to put a bunch of weld in here. If I could have gotten rid of that, I would have, but the more I weld this, the more I have to grind it back down. And this layer right here is super thin, and that layer right there is super thin. So it's better to leave well enough alone. If I'm really motivated, I can continue to try to work it from the back and try to push this thing out a little bit, but that requires pressure in the middle and then hammering around the outside, which is what you just saw me do, which by the way, worked really well. Like it's almost perfect, but you know, but I think you guys have seen the procedure enough now. If I decide I want to go down that road, I will, but I'm not too worried about it. So I spoke too soon. As I was doing some final hammer and dolly work, I poked a hole right through this super thin sheet metal. So I have weld on that side. I have thick sheet metal on that side. So what you do is you put this copper, I got a copper tube, I've smashed it. I can get it behind here and then you basically weld and the weld will stick and it won't stick to anything else. It won't stick to the copper. And it'll allow me to build this thing back up again And then of course I've got to have to shave it down. But that last little bit, I don't know if you guys can see this, but that last little bit I did just made this thing super smooth. I don't know what it was, but I feel like I released the tension of this. It's almost like there was a bump here and a bump here, and I released the tension, and now this thing feels like it's almost perfectly transitional. There's a little gap like right there, but I'm fine with it. So now I gotta weld this hole. Well, I just welded the ugliest wad. The second I put heat into this thing, it started melting, which is what I was trying to tell you guys before. I'm gonna have to grind this thing down and probably rework it a little bit, but I don't know if you guys can tell how much flatter this thing is now, but it really looks good other than now this giant alien wad. Very tempted just to cut out a patch panel here. So I don't know if I'll do that tonight, but yeah, if this gives me trouble as I grind it, I'm just gonna take a little X here and just put a patch panel in, good metal to good metal. Well, that was patience, patience, and more patience. Now, on the next video, I'm hoping to be able to take you in the machine shop. I've taken my adapter plate over to like literally the cutest old man named Bob. And Bob has been machining in this particular space for 42 years. And I'm not kidding, he's the cutest old man you've ever seen. I've asked him if it's okay if we come in and film the process of carving out the back of the adapter plate, and he said yes, so he's gonna call me tomorrow and hopefully I'll shoot over there with this camera and show you guys what that process is all about. Anyway, this feels pretty good to me. I feel pretty good about where it ended up, and I'm gonna clean up and hopefully the adapter plate comes back and we can start focusing on making the cradle for the engine, transmission, and pretty much any early 911 to put any Subaru motor in. So again, you guys are such friggin' rock stars. And thank you guys for telling me where you came from in the comments. I'd love to hear what country you're in, what state, what province, what island, what universe. Thank you so much for watching. Thank you for being here. We'll see you next time.